Good evening and welcome to the NDTV Dialogues, a conversation of ideas. This week, this month, sadly, we've been debating lynching and mob violence. But tonight on the show, we want to look more seriously at why this is happening in the 21st century, at a time when India is the world's fifth largest economy, is progressing in so many ways. Why are we going backwards in the terms of violence and lynchings? Joining me for this is a very special panel, a group of senior lawmakers. I'm joined by Harish Chandra Meena, MP from Dausa, Rajasthan of the BJP, also ex-director general of police. Also with me, Ashwini Kumar of the Congress, former law minister. Also, Mohammed, Salim, Lok Sabha MP of the CPIM. Tathagata Satpathy, Lok Sabha MP of the Biju Janata Dal. And a new MP, Sonal Mansingh, nominated to the Rajya Sabha, a voice of the arts and a voice of reason, as all our panelists are. Thank you very much. Meenaji, if I can begin by asking you, as MP from Rajasthan, where suddenly we're seeing all these incidents being reported. In your view, and your background as a senior police officer, why do you think this is happening? We had Arjun Meghwalji say that this is a conspiracy against the Prime Minister. Do you actually believe that?
See, my view is whatever is happening is unfortunate. But this is not new as far as the politics of Rajasthan is concerned. I'll just take you back about 10 years back. We had a very notorious agitation in Rajasthan, during which there's mass violence. All trains, all roads were closed. And hundreds of lives were lost. Even policemen on duty, they were lynched. And somehow, such people, they were not brought to book. They all, to date, no one has been arrested. So people, when they know, when they commit an offense in a mob, in anonymity, they have a feeling somehow they'll go scot-free. So if timely action is taken, it helps us in resolving a lot of things. And I would not call it a failure of a particular party or a failure of an individual. It's a failure of the state. State is an institution. Parties, individuals come and go. The state of India stays, survives. And to protect the life, liberty and property of any individual is the duty of the state. State is the custodian of my fundamental rights. And all these are fundamental rights. So somehow or somewhere if something is going wrong, I feel the various institutions of the state, be it the legislature, be it the executive, be it the judiciary, and even the press. Somehow, all of us are not playing the role which we should have played.
That's a very interesting point, the role of the state. And I think the opposition will argue, and Ashwini Kumar, if I can bring you in on that, the point he's making, and I think the Home Minister has also made the point that when you talk about mob lynchings, 1984 were the first and the most serious incidents of mob lynchings. So when you look at failures of the state and bringing those guilty to justice, it's actually been continuing for years. This is not something which is recent.
Yes, but the point is something that has happened in the past ought to be repeated. And the issue is not whether 1984 was the worst form of lynching or whether today is the worst time for lynchings. The issue is, and as has been rightly pointed out, that somewhere as a state, the Indian state and its instrumentalities have failed to address the problem. But the politics of lynching is something that we have seen for the first time in this country today. And I say so decisively and I say so advisedly and consciously that the politics of lynching used as a tool of politics in terms of polarizing sentiments and in terms of creating a fear psychosis in the minds of those who choose to be contrarian was never witnessed at a scale at which it is being witnessed now. As far as institutions of the state is concerned, I think I would be failing in my duty if I were not to commend the recent decision of the Supreme Court, which in an expansive exercise of its judicial review jurisdiction has directed Parliament to come up with a purposive, comprehensive law against lynching. Now, some may argue that things in India have gone bad not for want of laws, but perhaps for too many laws. That is one part of the argument. But it is equally true that something is necessary to create a fear in the mind of those that you will not go scot-free and there will be a law that will hold you to account. And that is where the role of the state is important. And because the state's role is an issue, obviously the ruling party's responsibilities are there.
Well, let me bring in Tathagata Satpathy here, who is with the Biju Janata Dal, as you saw in the recent no-confidence motion, neither this side nor that side. But let me just ask you on that, that when politics comes into it somehow, whether it's about saying 1984 is to blame or saying this government is to blame, we actually then don't get into solving the problem because both sides take defensive positions. How are we looking at this as a larger issue of our polity, of our society, of governance, which needs to be tackled. Do you think it's a political issue?
It is partly political, and I would say it is majorly a social evil that we have brought upon ourselves. Our inaction in the past, and I am not blaming any political party as such, all of us are responsible. Over a period of time, you know, whenever anybody is speaking in parliament, they always say, oh, in the past 70, 71 years since independence. Fine, we've had independence since 70 years from the British rule. But what has happened is we have, in the process, killed all social leadership. Mm-hmm. We have overly relied only on political leadership for solving all our problems, whether it is the clogging of our drain, or it is the education system falling through, or it is our financial economic situation. Whatever it is, we have no experts, we have no economists, we have no social leadership at all. So this over dependence on the political leadership is unjustified, because the politician today is an average citizen. She or he is not somebody who has dropped from heaven to give solace to everybody. And in the process, with excessive dependence on this one wing of society, which I would consider is a very small wing, because if you see the number of elected representatives in India, it would be something like 6,000, 7,000 people.
So you're saying you can't be the solution for everything, but do you think the politicians are to blame for what's happening now?
They would be as much to blame as anybody else. Like Meena Sahib said, it's the state. The state includes everybody. It includes the bureaucracy, it includes the civil society, it includes everybody. The artist, the dancer like Sonalji, like everybody is part of the state. We are all one country. So if you depend on only one wing of that whole setup, that mm-hmm. large setup, that they alone are the panacea to all evils, obviously it is failing through. Mohammed, and that is what we are seeing today.
Mohammed Salim ji, would you agree? Do you think that what we're seeing now is part of a larger political plan, as Ashwini Kumar says, or as Mr. Meena says, this is actually about a larger problem of the state, of the Indian state?
Of course, it's a bigger problem, but it's a culmination of so many issues. The time will not permit, but it has a psychological aspect, economic aspect, political, social, cultural, religious. It's a culmination. But of course, it's part of game, political game plan. Now, the political game plan is, you know, in modern world, this lynching was used as an instrument to establish white supremacy in US more than a century ago. The black youths
were... The Ku Klux Klan.
Yes. And then whole world took it as a violation of human rights. And it took decades for the change of societal attitude and legal framework. And in this country, it's not that when Modi ji came to power, it started. But it's slowly taking up. But the main thing is, if people not like us, then you don't have the right for a dignified life, your livelihood. So then that's how you establish this supremacy. So the Hindutva kind of politics, it's a project, it's a political project. For that reason, it's a majoritarianism kind of politics you have to establish. And earlier it used to be fringe elements. Now you see ministers, elected representatives, even police, even government people, they come not to defend the victims, but to defend the criminals, the perpetrators. And that's how that led to Minister Garland, the criminals. And instead of whole world or whole country coming together, that you condemn such things. Mohsin Sheikh was first lynched from Prime Minister to Parliament, everybody was silent. So that's how you give credence to. And the putting this 84 versus 2002, that means for one crime against vis-a-vis another crime. So let this continue. Should not be the approach.
I'm going to get Mr. Meena to answer those, but let me just get Sonal Mansingh in as a non-political voice in this. When you look at it, ma'am, as a citizen of India, now, as I said, as a newly elected Rajya Sabha MP, what do you think about what's currently happening with this kind of violence? It can, as I said, it can be from a WhatsApp rumor to whether it's about issues of cows and religion. What do you think about it?
When they speak of this mobocracy, the lynchings, the killings, and the mindless violence, what is a mob? Mob is a congregation It's a collective energy gone waste. It's the total mindlessness, like robotic people who have been told, go and do this. I object also to Mr. Salim bringing Hindutva angle. I think no party or no group of people in this country are devoid of such feelings. I'm sorry to say that. Okay. Number two, that the lack of social culture in the daily life and in the education system, increasingly there is a gap, there is a vacuum, and that there is nothing positive or concrete other than films and television and social media to fill that vacuum with positivity, with something that would contribute to the social upliftment. But you see, when you enter a mob, it's not a crowd. A mob is the worst word I can ever think of. Mm-hmm. Mob is just mindlessness. It's like the tsunami. Exactly. So the vacuum has to be filled with good things. And I think the artists have a very big role to play, which has been overlooked for the past decades.
Let me just bring in, well, Mr. Meena, both as an MP from Rajasthan and as an ex-police officer, just some of the issues raised by Mohammed Salim and Ashwini Kumar. The point about the state actually favoring the accused rather than the victim. In the case of Pehlu Khan, we know that all the people who he named in his dying declaration are out on bail. We know that Pehlu Khan's sons have cases against them for cow smuggling. So again, the victim is actually the one who's facing the crime. Again, what happened in the recent case with Rakhbar Khan, the police are the ones who the Home Minister of the state says are directly responsible for his death because they didn't take him to hospital. When the state seems to be favoring a side, do you think it is about politics?
I would not blame any political party or any individual. See, as per our legal system, the police is independent of the politicians. Police are agents of law, not agents of a
political
party.
But Mr. Meena, you're really telling me that the police doesn't favor the state government of whichever party, Congress, BJP, or Samajwadi party.
I'll give you an example. Whatever I say is based on facts.
Okay.
During 1984 riots, throughout North India, a lot of Sikhs were massacred, killed. But the state of Rajasthan, which has a very sizable Sikh population, and we are bordering Delhi, mm-hmm. not a single Sikh was killed. Because we had effective police officers. There was a DG called Raghunath Singh. He says no one should be harmed, and no one was harmed.
But we saw in 1984 how the Delhi police abdicated its responsibility.
So that is a failure of an individual.
No, it's failure of the Delhi police. Acting under,
whoever
acting
was
presumably
heading,
under
the same police,
rules.
Same government. We also had a Congress government sure. there. Nothing happened. So it is, if I fail, I cannot blame my government for it. It's my failure. I have not taken the right thing. Mm-hmm. So we should have people who are competent, who are placed on the basis of their competence, not otherwise. Efficient people, competent people. And you have there's no dearth of such people.
No, but speaking from Rajasthan, have you seen, you just talked about 1984 when Rajasthan was peaceful.
Yeah.
So why is it that Rajasthan is suddenly seeing so many incidents? You've seen even the traditional musician community, the Manganyars were targeted. You've seen the Mayo Muslim, where again, as you pointed out, Muslims and Hindus have lived in peace in Rajasthan for years. It's not like UP or Bihar or Gujarat where there has a history of communal riots. Why has Rajasthan changed?
Sonia ji, just give me an example.
Sure.
We talk of various political parties. In Rajasthan, we just have two political parties. We don't have regional parties. Mm-hmm. Which political party do you think, when it selects its candidates, they are on merit? Either they see his caste, they see his creed, what is the... So everyone practices this.
Mm-hmm.
So if you lose, you blame someone else. All of us as Indians, we have to rise above these things. Look into the person's qualities, his abilities, his aptitude, and not his caste.
Mm-hmm.
And I should be punished for my acts, not for my caste.
Mm-hmm.
But what is happening? Every political party. In UP, you see this community is supporting this, he'll win. You don't see the candidate. So when individuals, and I'll give you another example. And all states probably, but I spoke in the parliament also on this issue.
Mm-hmm.
It's the lawmakers who make the law. Either the MLAs or the MPs, not the councillors, not the Gram Panchayat. For a Gram Panchayat sarpanch, you have to be educated. You can't have more than two children. He doesn't make law, he follows law. But for a lawmaker like me, I can be uneducated. I can have as many children as I want. And I'm paid for it. So what are you paying? Competence or incompetence?
No, I agree with you. You're still not answering whether the state here is siding with the accused. Is the state siding with the criminals like Mohammed Salim said?
See, as state, police does not, it's not, when police does not work in isolation, there's a system called criminal justice administration system
mm-hmm.
in which it's the police, the prosecution, the magistracy, judiciary, and the jails. All of them, police should be, and police is as per law accountable to law, to the judiciary, not to a political master.
You want to respond, go ahead.
Coming to the concrete, the former police officer, and he candidly accepted what's happening, the things, but then in this case, the police is squarely blamed because it took 4 hours to 6 hours to take the victim injured to the nearest hospital, which is 6 kilometers away.
They had tea in between.
There's no judiciary, no prosecution, by the time no FIR, just you have to rescue and put him to the hospital for the treatment. And that is how this connivance is. And now that the lower level it is there, it's a human failure. When it's come to the upper level, it's a system failure. So whole state is to be blamed. But actually, the problem is that the societal mind change. We can see that if you are not speaking like me in the language, same language, you are not behaving like me, you are not wearing the clothes I wear, you don't eat what I eat, and you don't, your way of worship is different than mine. That means people like us and people not like us. If people is not like us, then you don't have a right to a life of dignity with dignity. That's the problem. That's the societal attitude is being changed. And I'm telling you again and again, when Akla is not new, the art, people of art and culture, they have a great role for this societal attitude to be changed positively. But then after Akla Khan was murdered by the same kind of thing, and award Vapsi, that's famous thing, Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, all these various fields people, what the government said that time, they should have acknowledged the problem is emerging and you have to tackle it. But instead of that, it's a manufacturing dissent. And they tried to sideline the entire thing. The signal was there. They have failed to take that cognizance.
You want to respond? Go ahead. When activists speak, he says that they're targeted for being anti-national. Go ahead.
I was targeted, Mr. Salim, for having been appointed chairman of Sangeet Natak Academy by NDA. I was for the first time don't, because you're CPM. And UPA won.
Hello,
second, Mr. Salim. Let me speak.
That
this is not episode. Parliament. Hello.
No, I'm saying
that. Let me speak. Please. I do not like to be interrupted. Please. With 64 CPM MPs, UPA 1 came into power. And that is when the first political interference in the field of culture happened in independent India. There was intolerance, total intolerance. We were swept out with a jhadu. Why? Not because I was incompetent, not because I had shown any...
That's why now all bodies will be filled by...
Okay, let her finish. Let her finish a point.
No, justification. Wrong is wrong.
No, but let her finish what she's saying. Go ahead.
So what I'm saying is that pointing fingers at other parties, taking one each name, then I can also say that I read newspapers, I see, I watch TV. What happened during CPM rule in West Bengal for 34 years or 37 years? What happened now with Trinamool, you know, those hangings of those poor boys? See, selectivity and selective amnesia does not help. I'm sorry. Amnesia does not help.
And I think that's a valid point. And Ashwini Kumar, if I can bring you in, the fact is that the Congress also has often been now with deciding whether it is becoming a party which is no longer seen as pro-Muslim, anti-Muslim, even the fact, and Ashok Gehlot has said this on NDTV, the fact that the Congress itself has not visited any of the victims of these horrific lynchings. The point was being made that Jayant Sinha garlanded the convicts who were released on bail, but Jayant Sinha didn't meet the widow of the man who died. But has the Congress met in Rajasthan the people who have actually died or not?
Well, I'm sure that the local leadership must have gone there. I'm not aware of the facts, but I have absolutely no doubt that the local Congress leadership must have gone and visited those houses. But you know, there's also another point here. People say that when leaders visit the victims of lynchings or victims of rape or victims of mass violence, there's nothing more than tokenism and symbolism. So sometimes there's a tendency not to visit right then when an incident had occurred. But to come back to the major point that you are talking about, there is absolutely no doubt in my mind that what we are witnessing today is the failure of the Indian state in its ability or willingness or inclination to preserve, protect and defend the dignitarian ethos of our constitution. Our right to dignity, our right to freedom of expression, our right to live in peace and harmony amongst ourselves is being seriously threatened by a coalescence of societal and political forces which have today come to believe that they have a literal license to kill at will. That's what is a major cause of fear. The fear psychosis that has now been created in this country bodes ill not only for our democracy but for our fundamental human rights. And let me tell you, wherever fascism has come in a creeping way. It has not come as from above, from anywhere else. It creeps into the system and one sees the inevitable consequence of the psychosis of the psychology of fear that has gripped the country, leading to a kind of debilitating of our democracy, which is very unfortunate.
But let me ask, and Mr. Satpathy, the point is that India, in a sense, and the Indian state.
Can I?
Yes, go ahead. Pitching.
There is a fear of me being hauled up for treason. But I have a very strong opinion, which is getting stronger by the day nowadays, that India is not actually one country. We are creating a mirage ourselves. Our cultural side of our life has shrunk to either Hindi films and songs or some little evening performances of an artist or a dancer or a theater. That is culture for us. Beyond that, culture for the average Indian is non-existent. So we have created a country today just by a political amalgamation. Otherwise, what similarity is there between a man in, say, Tuticorin and, say, in Patna, or a man from Bhubaneswar with somebody in Porbandar? There's absolutely no similarity.
And is it the kind of clashes between these different, between the diversity and trying to impose a uniformity, which is the issue?
Three Oriya youths were attacked in Madras, in Chennai recently. Because they were coming back from work, they saw some urchins, they started giving them gifts of little chocolates, little coffees.
And they became child lifters.
And they were labeled as child lifters. Yes. They were chased, one of them was caught, but they managed to save themselves. But this is what is happening. You look different from me, you don't speak my language. What Salim ji, I think, was talking now.
No, and that's what I want to ask. In fact, Mr. Meena, when you talked about the Indian state, it's actually also the resilience of the Indian state, that we have come through so many seismic things, communal riots, we have survived the Indian state, we have moved forward and we have learned. Is this a different phase we are seeing, that at least after what happened, say, up till the 2000s, that we don't see any large-scale communal riots anymore because of maybe the presence of better policing, the question of now 24/7 media, the focus much more. But now it's these individual kind of cases, lynchings that are targeting, whether it's minorities, whether it's targeting Dalits, whether it's even targeting the outsider. The outsider can be Odia, the outsider can be from the Northeast, or the outsider. That this is the new problem that is facing India today. And this perhaps is what political forces are capitalizing on, whether you say it happens to all political parties, but this is also part of a political project.
See, I'll view it in a very positive manner. Now you don't hear of large-scale communal riots.
Yes.
You don't hear of large-scale caste riots, what you used to witness in Bihar or this thing. Ranveer Sena, this Sena, killing, coming. No,
Delhi massacre, Bhagalpur, so many.
That means the people have matured. They moved beyond this. You can't fool them. It's good. It's a maturing of a system. And do not forget, we are an old civilization but a very young country. We are just 70 years old as an independent country. We are not used to democratic setups, either to the Britishers, Mughals and the Rajas. So we are maturing up and it goes to the credit of the people of India and Indian civilization and Indian history, that in spite of so many diversities what were talked of, we are surviving and we are getting stronger by every passing day. So I see a very positive side.
I wish I could be as optimistic as Meena ji, but I'm worried. I'm worried because compared to the past, we are not showing maturity. Cowvigilantism, everyday instances of rape, everyday instances of custodial torture, everyday instances of atrocities on young children, on infants. This was never there. Now you may say this was always there, but it was never reported. It's not like that. The society has ceased to be compassionate. People have ceased to be sensitive. There is a complete sensitization to the agony of other people. The case of three daughters having to break their roof to give agni to their dying mother. Nobody in the village came even to give wood for the sanskar of that poor lady.
and the case in Odisha, every day being reported that a person is carrying his dead wife on a cycle or on his shoulders for kilometers. What do you talk? What do you say about
once.
What do you say about this society? I think our society,
every day.
Our society has coarsened. Our society has become insensitive. We are not a better nation. Over the years, we've become a worse nation. The resilience of the Indian state should not be confused with the resilience of Indian democracy. Indian democracy is resilient, I agree. But the Indian state is getting debilitated on a daily basis.
Go ahead, ma'am.
I think that we should not forget the negative role of social media, of television. Why I say this? Whether it's a cricket match or a World Cup football, or it's a movie, or it's funeral, or killings in the news and lynching, you just sit there watching your TV from the drawing room, eating your pizza, or drinking this, drinking that, chatting. And you just surf the channels. What you're saying, sir, I agree with you, the insensitivity has increased. Because A, the volume of people, the mass population of India is bursting at the seams. Also, the easy availability on your mobile, you're just looking at the news, or you just surf it, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Earlier, there was a connect. Today, you know, it's made joke of that four people, two parents, mother, father, and two children, and all four of them are not talking to each other. They are at the mobile.
Of course, but
so insensitivity.
But ma'am, that's happening around the world. So
yes,
I think
but Sonia ji, around the world, then you know what is happening. We are only talking about India.
But we're talking about
what's happening.
No, but we're talking about a democratic society where you talk about lynchings.
You know what's happening in Canada and America and France and Germany and Belgium. You know what's happening.
Of course, but I still would see that you won't see lynchings like this because it would be seen as a law and order issue. And I want to bring in Mohammed Salima. Go ahead. You want to talk? Because also, we're talking about this somehow as a larger law and order issue. Indians can't. But your point you're making, and I'm going to ask you, Ms. Meena, also the statistics show that just if you go by cow-related violence since 2010, India Spent has done a study which says 84% who died in this violence are Muslims. 97% of these attacks of cow-related vigilantism are after 2014. So we can't just look at this as law and order. I'll come to you, sir, on that, but go ahead.
Yes. Of course, at the end, the crime is perpetrated as a law and order, but it's not a law and order. The origin is, when you started this, we are going for a globalized economy and localized politics. That's why this large scale, whole country is not burning at the same time. People are also matured. I'm not that pessimistic. Now, justification can be there. You can blame technology, you can blame people. But the question is insensitive society and irresponsive governance. The government, that's why when the incidents first take place, you have to take the responsibility. So, Prime Minister himself has said once about this cow vigilantism, by day they are gorakshas, by night they are criminals. But at the end of the day, what you're seeing is this, this administration is without connivance of the part of the administration. This kind of mob lynching cannot be anywhere in the world, cannot sustain. One or two isolated incidents can take place. But there's a pattern in this madness. And that pattern is you are dividing the population and by either rumor or by some campaign, and every day, even sitting in the television channel, even in parliament, even in other social platforms, we find that not only in social media, this divisiveness is growing.
The worst kind of communism, in fact, is on TV channels.
It's a hate crime. Actually,
yes.
It's a hate crime based on hatred spread.
Yes, go ahead.
I am addressing another issue. There is an economic issue involved in this. What happens, what I have seen in my state also, with this violence raging mostly in North India, see, who sells the cows that are taken away by these cow people who get them slaughtered and, you know, sell the skin? It's the Hindu farmer. I had spoken about this in Parliament also. Mm-hmm. What happens, an average farmer has a pair of bullocks and maybe one or two cows. And when the animals become old and are incapable of working, the man, the farmer or the family sells this set of bullocks. What money they get acts as a seed money. They buy another set so that they can continue with their ploughing.
Yes.
In a state like Orissa, we still use bullocks for ploughing. All right. Now with these people, unfortunately, they all happen to belong to one particular religion, Muslims. But when they got scared, they are not going to the villages anymore. The resultant fact is that now the farmers cannot sell their bullocks or their old non-milch cows. What do they do? On an average, I found out from my constituency, on an average, a pair of bullocks eats fodder for about 100-120 rupees a day.
Mm-hmm.
In a month, a pair needs about medication for about 100 rupees. So it's about 3,000-3,200 rupees per month, which is a lot of money for a farmer. What do they do now? They just let the animals go wild, just open them.
No, it's happening in Uttar Pradesh as well, because the...
It's happening all over now.
This is Rajasthan, state-run Gosala.
Salimji, it's the Hindu farmer. It's got nothing to do with Hindu-Muslim in that sense. Mm-hmm. It's the Hindu farmer who's getting affected.
No, and the recent attack in Uttar Pradesh was also on the four people transporting the buffalo were Hindu and Muslim. So often when it becomes a mob, it doesn't anymore.
Right, sir, exactly.
But Mr. Sonia, let Mr. Meena
answer. With Muslims, the victims are also Dalits. In Una flogging case, we know. Yes. Because at the end, the receiving end, you have the scheduled caste people also, and that's why they are also resentment because is they, there.
No, but let me actually ask Mr. Meena, because just those statistics I told you, Mr. Meena, it's clear that the... Just going by the figures, now this is not political or not, the majority of the people who are targeted in cow-related violence are Muslims. So how can you say that it's not an issue? You said, ma'am, that don't use the word Hindutva. But how can you say that there's not an issue which involves religion or communalism here in the targeting of particular groups?
Sonia ji, there are 33 districts, revenue districts in Rajasthan.
Yes.
All these incidents relate to one district. So you cannot call it a widespread, this thing. Had it been an organized thing, mm-hmm. you should have seen these things in other districts also. And why in this particular district?
Mm-hmm.
There's an area called Mewat, where Mew Muslims live.
Yes.
This is bordering Haryana and
yes.
Rajasthan. This complaint of cow slaughter, cow theft by the Mews is age old. It's not a new thing. You see, in any number of cases, earlier what used to be, people were they were angry about it. It's not a question of all of a sudden anger has come up at it. They were angry. And there were umpteen number of cases where police used to fire at these smugglers. They used to beat the police. They used to fire at the police. They are also armed people.
Mm-hmm.
See, they are into trade. This is economic trade, illegal trade. Slaughter of cows in Rajasthan is banned by law since 1995.
Mm-hmm.
There's a law to it.
Mm-hmm.
Even the movement of cows from one place to this place, it has to be of a particular age, particular this thing, a description, then only you can transport it. So it was there. Now, somehow the people feel the state is not going to do anything. I refuse to believe. I put in 38 years of service in the police department. Mm-hmm. I'm yet to come across a politician of any shade who will tell the police, let him get killed. This is policemen on their own, if they are doing something, but no political party or a sane politician would ever say this thing.
Well, this argument, let me quote you what Jaswant Yadav, a minister in the Rajasthan government, said. He said, well, if cows are smuggled, Hindus' blood boils. What do you think the interpretation of that statement would be to his constituents? That's somehow a justification. You said cow smuggling is banned, of course, and it's illegal, but murder is banned. Can a cow, as I think the Congress says, or Shashi Tharoor has said, that it's now safer to be a cow in India than a Muslim?
See, you've heard our state, Home Minister's statement. He's condemned the police, he's the Home Minister, he's a BJP man.
He condemned the police of Akbar Khan, Pehlu Khan.
Earlier
he said you don't need a separate law for lynchings.
The police officer... A police officer's team was sent to Alwar.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. N.R.K. Reddy was the special DU, was the head of the... He condemned. He found the police was found wanting.
Mm-hmm.
So who's shielding them? It's a failure of a police department.
No, I'm not saying they're shielding the police. They're shielding the Gau Rakshaks. So they're not... I won't even call them Gau Rakshaks because they're actually just criminals. They're shielding the people who are murdering them.
A criminal is a criminal, and anyone who tries to shield a criminal, he doesn't have a caste, he doesn't have a creed or religion.
But look at Yogi Adityanath. He has just said... human lives are important, but so are cows. So you are equating cow with a human life, okay. and at the same, it's a kind of a bizarre argument.
I want to bring in Sonal Mansingh on that, because just that aspect, and perhaps that aspect is true, that you said don't bring Hindutva, why are you politicizing it? Look at what West Bengal government did, look at what Congress government did. But given today's situation, because it is a BJP government, let's not go into the past. With the current BJP government, do you think that this justification is valid? It's cow smuggling, so people get angry, so, there are casualties on the way. Do you agree with that?
So, this is all very serious discussion, Sonia, but I think somehow you tend to take it into one channel only, and you say, let's not talk of the past. But everything in the past connects to present.
Of course.
And yes, of course.
But the current government should repeat the mistakes of the past.
There is a reflection, there is a connection. And that is from where the whole thing flows. I would like to say is that in today's circumstances, given in India, in every corner of India, more or less. There are explosive statements being made, explosive situations being created. I think for want of better opportunities maybe, or because of high rising ambitions. There are a lot of people who just want to make quick money. There are a lot of people who want to make quick name and fame. You do something nonsense, you say something stupid, and it all appears on your TV and media. That also is a very, very bad thing that's happening. But I think today we must condemn in every part of India what happens in Kerala, killing people, killing cows, killing vigilantes. Everything bad is bad. I don't want to only talk about cows. I want to talk about rapes and murders of little, little girls, even babies. I would rather say that murderous activities have to be condemned, have to be punished.
Yes.
Full stop.
Final thoughts. What are solutions we can look at? And I do think that when once we get politics into it, the solutions go out of the window. What are solutions Parliament can look at?
Ultimately, politicians have to offer this solution because through parliamentary system. And in that case, in 2015, we discussed this lynching in Lok Sabha. In fact, Ram Vilas Paswan, I still remember, the minister from NDA. He suggested, and I immediately jumped in supporting that, that let there be a stringent act, because criminal laws, justice system does not recognize this mob lynching. So I said, Rajnath Singh was there, Home Minister. I said, once the minister of NDA is suggesting, I have no objection.
And the Supreme Court support, now says there should be a separate law.
And Supreme Court later on came to that. But the now question is not that because of smuggling. You want to kill someone, you give a bad name. That's not should not be there. Otherwise, why Swami Agnivesh was attacked? It's a question of this intolerance. And at the same time, Junaid was murdered on a train. Where is the cow smuggling? He said, I'm not fasting, I'm in Roza. I don't eat. If you're not your father, when Eklak was killed, it was in the fridge. You were trying to find out some beef. So this cow smuggling thing is an alibi. Actually, it is economic, of course. Economic activities there from Qureshi brothers who deal with meat, from this scheduled caste to workers who deal with the Una flogging case was not for smuggling. They were just skinning the hidden skin.
No, I accept that those are heinous, but as Sonal Mansingh ji said, what about then when killings happen in Kerala? So, what about when they happen under CPIM government?
So positive thing is first a societal attitude. People like, great people like, you know, not just Denshaw, but a social activist also. These people should create in the mind, instead of supporting someone doing this thing, it's a wrong thing. Wrong is wrong. This time or earlier or later. And it should not happen. Prime Minister should also say the same thing. Otherwise, the technical techies are also murdered. So, secondly, legal system. There is no dearth of law. Let there be good law, but execute the law enforcing authority. And don't blame the state government, central government, because state government is a law enforcing. It's not a law and order. It's like terrorism. It's our big problem, and we have all collectively have to address this.
Exactly.
And don't.
So do you think the group of ministers now headed by the Home Minister will help? Do you think
No.
Why
this
not?
Committee system, I'm telling you, I'm an old parliamentarian since 1990. It's just buying time. Otherwise, Supreme Court is saying you do this, now a group of ministers, now a group of secretaries, and when the minister's defending that in 1984 it has happened, Home Minister is saying in the floor of the house, so this is going to happen. So that intention is not clear. You
well,
have to make your intent very clear that you are hard on this and you don't tolerate. Prime Minister should have come in the very first place that this country,
well,
we don't tolerate such things.
Well, perhaps it's time to call it.
Would you say this message?
Your government in Kerala also?
And this is what I would read. That's why he's his reward. I'm sorry to say that. Talking about this serious problem,
I totally agree with you, sir, that this is the most serious.
Lynching is lynching. That's everywhere.
But why do you get so violent when I just point out, sir, you know, would you say this is also
you just now, you preach now that you don't interfere when I'm speaking. But it's the same thing.
But it is a valid question. And I think we should accept the fact that perhaps an all-party meeting looking at solutions is the answer.
Not about
we should meeting? Perhaps look at an all-party meeting
so
on this. Look at an all-party meeting where everybody comes together to look at solutions.
Why no all-party meeting was convened? Why Chief Minister's Conference or Home Minister's Conference was convened on this?
No, well,
let's talk about intention.
Hopefully Parliament is functioning this time. Something will change. Go ahead, Tathagata Satpathy.
The government is functioning.
Final thoughts on the solutions. My stand
that we have lost out a great opportunity of building up a social leadership. with excessive dependence on political leadership, this country is failing. If you remember, there was a movement in the US called Occupy Wall Street. And after that, when the Trump election took place, the whole narrative changed. Narrative, that's a popular
word. Well, look who won that election. Mr. Satpathy, Occupy Wall Street clearly didn't work. Look who won that election.
No, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. The narrative changed and it was occupy public space. Now, even in India, if you go into any airport, any railway station, you will understand what I am saying by occupy public space, occupy public mind. By occupying public space and public mind, what we are consciously trying to do is drive away thoughts about unemployment, thoughts about development. Development also has come into a big ambiguous light. What is development?
So you're saying Hindu-Muslim is diverting from key issues like jobs, farm crisis?
Yes. So these are alibis, these are excuses that all of us are doing.
To
I'm not blaming
the
BJP or Mr. Narendra Modi or any individual. All of us are I would hold the Congress the most responsible for creating a situation in the past decade for which India has landed where it is today. I would hold the Congress primarily responsible. Their attitude of not caring, the attitude of the senior ministers. You know, there was a minister who's undergoing a lot of trials and tribulations now.
You may as well take his name then.
He would talk like this and tell us, main hoon na. See, that kind of an attitude damaged the fabric of India. Today, I think it might, that is why I said it might be that
I think that's a bit of an overstatement. To lay the blame on one minister's door, I have to say, for damaging the
fabric of India. All of them were like that. All of them.
Well, Ashwini Kumar is the minister. I'm going to get him on that. But just to say, why doesn't the political leadership...
Why doesn't maybe a stage has come where we should become like CIS states. Let every state become independent. Let us be a loose federal setup.
That can have a separate dialogue on.
But and come together once we decide that we really need each other.
But let me
now
say,
we do not need each other.
But let me say, Mr. Satpathy, that why doesn't...
That's why. You are from Orissa.
Exactly. And the Orissa elections are coming, which is also nice. But let me say, Mr. Satpathy, why is
Orissa elections are synced with the parliament elections.
Exactly. You all are ahead of time.
Yeah,
yes.
We have done that. Our chief minister did that in 2004.
But Mr. Satpathy, let me ask you, why has your chief minister not, and like you may attack, but say Mamata Banerjee has come out and made it very clear where she stands on an issue like lynchings. Naveen Patnaik has stayed silent. Why is it, in fact, we talk about people who must come out, we talk about why the Prime Minister doesn't speak out, but when Chief Minister like Naveen Patnaik also don't come out and speak out strongly, why not?
I'm a direct beneficiary and a long-term beneficiary of the largesse and the kindness of Naveen Patnaik. So whatever I say may be held as a biased opinion. But let me tell you something. My Chief Minister, he's a proper gentleman. He believes in executing things within his domain. He is in charge of Orissa. Do you ever hear such weird things happening in Orissa? No. The clear directive to the state machinery is, you take care. And they are taking care. Mm-hmm. He holds up anybody. Even senior bureaucrats are hauled up if there is a slip.
Okay.
So he takes care of that area.
Okay.
Why should he go around shooting his mouth off?
Well, in the case that he's not shooting his mouth off, it may be also a voice of reason. But go ahead, Ashwini Kumar, the Congress is to blame. But also let's look ahead.
My good friend, Mr. Satpathy, is one of our very erudite and very sensitive politicians. And I normally tend to agree with most of the things that he says. But I'm afraid I can't agree with his statement that the problems of the present are all relatable to the governance of the Congress in the past. I think that is
obviously
a gross overstatement. I think a lot of very good things have been done by the Congress in the past, and that is why we are here where we are, the sixth largest economy, a great democracy, and so forth and so on. But today, the subject of the debate, which is a very serious subject, and I would like to compliment NDTV for taking up this subject, is what should be done about these gross aberrations that are a permanent, indelible scar on the face of the Indian Constitution and the Indian state. I would hasten to add that, for starters, let the leaders lead. Nations are led by those who claim themselves to be leaders across the political spectrum. But the leader of the nation is the Prime Minister of the country. The Prime Minister of the country must speak out more, must speak out repeatedly and thoroughly
against such aberrations like lynching, rapes, murders, atrocities on infants, and custodial torture. Today, I had a meeting with Mr. Rajnath Singh, and I pleaded with him for a stand-alone law on custodial torture. I filed a public interest petition in my own name, in the Supreme Court, in which the Law Commission of India, the Human Rights Commission of India, and the Attorney General, and everybody said, yes, this petition ought to be admitted, the law should be passed. Mm-hmm. The Chief Justice said, since everybody is conceding, Dr. Kumar, why, I am sure the government will pass an anti-custodial law. It has not been passed in the last 9-10 months. So I today requested the Honorable Home Minister that I don't want to go back to the court to ask for a directive like in the lynching case. So the issue is, who leads? Who's responsible for lawmaking? Who's responsible for law enforcement? The governments of the day, whether it is a Congress government or a BJP government or a CPM government.
So the accountability
Is of the executive. And that accountability just cannot be avoided or brushed aside. And those in the seat of power must be held accountable for the inadequacies of governance and for the failings of governance. And this I say so, irrespective of which party is in power.
In fact, interestingly, most of the lynchings have happened in North Indian states and Karnataka. So it is, of course, across, as I said, governments. But finally, Mr. Meena, as the BJP representative on the panel and as a politician today, do you wish that that accountability, and I'm sure as a police officer, you must say the politician wants it, it'll happen. Whatever you may say, police being independent, this being, if there is political will, anything can happen in this country. Do you think there is political will of your government, both in Rajasthan and the center, to stop these lynchings?
Sonia ji, first let me correct myself. I'm not a BJP spokesperson.
You're a BJP MP.
Yeah. He is here as a gentleman.
I hope he can be both.
I'm just speaking as a former police officer.
No, but as a BJP MP as well.
I'm an MP also, but I'm not the spokesperson of my party.
Understood. Okay.
So what I speak is for myself.
Yes.
It's not a party.
Yes.
This thing. But you wanted a solution. There's no dearth of laws. What is the execution of laws? Like whenever a lapse takes place or a crime takes place in someone's jurisdiction, that responsibility must be fixed. If a lynching takes place, no one can support it. And the officer who is supposed to prevent it, because the duty of the police is prevention and investigation. It is prevention first. So prevention, aap karoge, to apraad hoga hi nahi. So why did they fail in their primary duty of preventing a crime? They should be that. You don't require a law for it. It's an administrative decision.
No, sir, but I'm asking you about political will. I understand you're not a BJP spokesperson, but do you think as a BJP MP that there is political will of the government at the state and the centre to stop this?
Any government.
Yes, agreed. Karnataka government also. Any government.
Any government which represents the people and which claims to safeguard the interests of the and welfare of the people has to do it. There's no question, there's no choice. We are the custodians of life, liberty and property of every citizen, irrespective of his caste and creed. So this, I am yet to come across any of this thing. Please, it's a crime. It's a heinous crime. Do not give it a colour of our religion, party or state. It's a crime against humanity.
Well, those are strong words, and I think words that everyone on this panel will agree with. These are crimes against humanity, the murders, wherever they're happening. Thank you all very much for joining me on the NDTV Dialogues, and I hope there's much more dialogue to address this heinous crime, this tragic problem currently in India. Thank you all very much for joining me. Thank you.